Good morning to you. Mark Seth, HurricaneTrack.com here. I am in Rodanthe on the North Carolina Outer Banks, where I'm going to be setting up equipment starting today. And I'm producing this video discussion from a good friend of mine's house right here on the Outer Banks, about as far east as you can get. I'll show you where I am in just a minute on a map as I wrap things up. There's a lot to talk about, so let's get to it. More than just Florence, I want to touch on the impacts and the forecast for Olivia right now, located still pretty far to the east-northeast of Hawaii. And the forecast track brings this right through the central part of the islands. And the impacts here are going to be far different, it looks like, than what they experienced from Lane, in that there will be some pretty heavy rain, this time probably spreading over Maui and Oahu. It is possible still, too, to see some heavy rain over the Big Island, and it's just a matter of where the bands set up and what the organization of Olivia is like as this passes through. This is what the satellite imagery looks like. The deeper convection or thunderstorm activity, the rising motion in the atmosphere there, those reds disappearing, which is a good sign. The center of circulation probably right in here somewhere, but that's a lot of moisture that will be heading in this direction down here. And remember, this is rotating counterclockwise like this, right? So the wind and the rain is going to come at the islands like this as it comes through. And so it's still going to be on the windward side, but it should overtake the islands. Once this gets close enough where I can show you a radar, probably in the evening update today, we can analyze that a little bit better. All right. Moving on along, this is Isaac down here, and you can just see how busy the Atlantic Basin is. There's Isaac. We'll examine that next here. And it's forecast to become a hurricane again briefly, and then due to stronger upper-level winds across this region, presumably it'll weaken back to tropical storm strength, but you never know. The models are kind of waffling on the intensity, so it's best to be prepared. And some of these islands down here that were so heavily impacted last year could receive up to hurricane conditions, certainly heavy rain, rough local seas, etc., as this moves through. So, you know, don't let your guard down yet. It's not a major hurricane or anything of that nature, like we saw with Irma and Maria, of course, but it's coming. So please take it seriously, and it should move into the Caribbean Sea here, the Eastern Caribbean, and then strange at the peak of the hurricane season to have something so well developed as it is, basically look like it's going to dissipate at some point through here. We'll watch that because that's not a certainty, but I guess the conditions down here in the deep tropics are still rather unfavorable with strong upper-level winds, and we'll just have to hope for the best that this does indeed fizzle out. We do have Invest Area 95L here in the Northwest Caribbean Sea, and this is forecast, if we look at the actual graphical version of this, to move in towards the Texas coast. And the big thing is going to be very heavy rain. And we know from last year, going to hammer on this every time, it's just a rain event. I don't want to ever hear that again, ever. So please keep your eyes on this and prepare accordingly as it marches along and maybe tries to develop as it does so. All right, so this is a satellite animation of Isaac here from the Tropical Tidbit site. This is Helene, a very well-developed hurricane. And, of course, this is Florence, kind of ebbing and flowing. And I think it's on the ebb or maybe the flow. I don't know. And that was a botched analogy, but it is. It's going back and forth on the intensity with eyewall replacement cycles. Very complex what happens within the core of a tropical cyclone, especially an intense hurricane. But this one's Isaac right here, and you know it's got some decent outflow with it. I'm not sure exactly what the problem is for why it's not stronger. Not complaining, but when you just look at the infrared satellite picture here, there are no obvious signs to me as to why this is, quote, still just a tropical storm. Nevertheless, you'll take what you can get over here in the islands as this passes through. The impacts, you know, regardless of whether or not it's 70 or 80 miles per hour, they're generally the same. Hurricane conditions are close to it, lots of heavy rain, gusty winds, and locally rough sea state. All right? So let's see. What do we have next? I'm trying to remember. Yep, of course, it's Florence. Before we get to the track, Matt, let me just show you the satellite animation. The little blip you see right at the beginning, right there, that's called the satellite eclipse. It's just a brief moment where the satellite is, the sun that energizes the satellite gets blocked. And so you have this little bit of an outage. I mean, I think that's what it is. We used to have a much longer satellite eclipse until the GOES-16 was launched. And it would be like a couple of hours or something where we had no updated satellite imagery in the Atlantic Basin. All right, so Florence, not looking quite as impressive as it did yesterday, which is good news, I suppose, but, I mean, it doesn't matter sitting out here in the middle of the Atlantic. That's why I say that. It matters once it gets up here. What does it look like? What is the structure? And there is plenty of warm ocean water. In fact, it probably gets warmer through here in this area, to be honest with you, especially with the Gulf Stream. And we're going to analyze that more probably in the evening update or maybe tomorrow, trying to throw a different variety of information pieces at you as we get closer to impact, because that's what's really going to matter. So the track, speaking of impact, shifted a little bit north yesterday and now has sort of steadied here on the areas in terms of the core near Jacksonville, North Carolina, roughly, for the center. And as such, a hurricane watch from the North Carolina-Virginia border down to Edisto Island, Edisto Beach, or is it Edisto? You think I would not think it's Edisto, but anyway. In South Carolina, that's a pretty large area for a hurricane watch, if I'm being honest. I don't remember seeing a watch that large. And I don't know. I will have to figure out if that means something, that there's maybe more threat to South Carolina starting to develop. I'm just not that sure. And there's also a storm surge watch that is a relatively new product in effect for the same area. That life-threatening storm surge is forecast and could take place for this area down here. And we're going to look at those hazards here in the Florence public advisory. And this part here, hazards affecting land. And these are the impacts. This is a big reason why my app is called Hurricane Impact. Because at the end of the day, we can track it all you like. Everybody wants to know where it's going to track. But I'm trying to get people to focus at least an equal amount of attention, if not more, on the impact, or what they call here hazards affecting land. And the storm surge, a very dangerous storm surge of possibly 6 to 12 feet from Cape Fear. And that would include Carolina Beach, Wrightsville Beach, Keary Beach, all the way up to the Pamlico and Neuse River areas, 6 to 12 feet. Cape Lookout to Ocracoke Inlet, 5 to 8 feet. And this is above ground level. This is not the surge mixed in with the tide. This is the flooding, the inundation above ground level, especially if the peak surge occurs at the time of high tide. And with the slow movement projected for Florence, I think it's inevitable that there would be a high tide or two, maybe, as this surge is coming in. Rainfall is also not good at all. 15 to 20 inches with isolated areas of 30. That will cause tremendous flooding in a very large area. And that inland flooding is a very dangerous, lethal effect, and people drive through that flood water. It just drives me nuts when I see that and I read about it, because it is 100% preventable. Honestly, you know, you stay in your home in an area away from surge, far inland, and hurricane winds come in and knocks a tree over, and it kills a person or two in that house. That's just a tragic, very random, unfortunate event that couldn't be prevented, because you can't tell everybody to evacuate the path of a hurricane. But when people drive their car, any automobile, through flood water on purpose, you know, it's not like they're running from something or whatever. You know, it's just, it makes me upset, because it's 100% preventable and we need to do better. So I don't know, talk about it and just, you know, honey, make sure you don't drive through that flooded area if it happens, like we see on our street all the time when it rains hard. This time could be different. Maybe something gets washed out. I'm just trying to help you folks, okay? I like being able to have you on the other side to talk to. I'd be very bored in terms of my business. I still have a great family that would keep me quite occupied, thank you very much. But if you're not on the other side, you know, what am I going to do for my job, right? So please stay safe. So the rainfall, yep, that's a very big deal. And then, yeah, hurricane conditions. This could be a very major wind event for where this makes landfall, spreading inland. The power outage situation on this one, folks, it is going to be epic. How many people are without power and how long? And I'm serious. You better hope you've got all the stuff you need to keep your devices charged, whatever, food, water, any medicines, because the power outage situation for eastern North Carolina is going to just be unbelievable. And then, of course, the surfers, they're enjoying the swell, etc. But this can be very dangerous if you are not careful. So let's take a little bit of a visit to Model Land. This is the GFS off of the NCEP site, the National Centers for Environmental Prediction. And this is the 6Z run. It's run four times per day. And this is the initial condition. It says 06 UTC, which is the same as 6Z. And this is the signature of Florence at about 5,000 feet in the atmosphere. It shows the structure, the vorticity. And you also see a little bit of the outline of the ridging and other steering patterns. We won't get too much into that, as I just want to show you the animation. And this is 5 days of the animation here. And we'll stop it right as it gets towards the coast here. See how it slows down right there? That's not me slowing down the frame rate. That's the slow motion, and I stopped it there, of Florence coming in, and it stops just shy of making landfall, pretty much where the National Hurricane Center shows it. And then if we keep this going, this, by the way, is hour 82. And there's hour 96, landfalling off and on across the Outer Banks, and then it moves southwest. And we'll speed this up just a little bit. See that slow motion? And why is it doing that? Well, it's being steered around this area of high pressure over here fairly briskly. You see that is coming around the backside of the high, and then that high pressure kind of lets go a little bit. And so it doesn't have that influence pushing on it as much. And everything's moving around at the same time. It's very complicated. And so this suggests that the high pressure maybe influences it being pushed down this way a little bit after landfall or whatever this meandering is, that the pressures, or what we call the heights, build again, shoving it back to the southwest. Whether or not this happens exactly as we're seeing remains to be seen. But this is a very interesting run nevertheless. You can also see, just to point this out, the structure of Isaac down here in the Caribbean that comes in from the right. Luckily, it doesn't have the same look, all that incredible vorticity and energy. Isaac looks completely different, which is great news for the Caribbean and the eastern islands there. So here, the last 6 runs of the Euro showing the landfall, remarkably consistent. It's not spread out all over the place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Basically, south and west of Wilmington, North Carolina, which is right there. I think that's very interesting, considering that the Hurricane Center forecast track is right through here, roughly. So they are well to the north and east, relatively, of the European, which is regarded as generally the best global model that we have. And you can see that the European model has not wavered much at all. We'll see, right? I don't know what to say. I'm just showing you. It's hard to interpret these things. This is just another representation of last night's run of the European. These tweets here from Ben Noel. And you can see how the hurricane comes up right over Cape Fear, and then it kind of veers to the west here a little bit into South Carolina, northeast parts of South Carolina. And again, the power outage situation through here is just going to be unreal, as will the heavy rainfall. And with a scenario like this, you could start to bring that heavy rainfall over the sand hills here and maybe closer to the Charlotte area. So this thing's just evolving and evolving and evolving. It's very aggravating. If you're going to get hit by a hurricane, I think we could all agree that you would rather it just come in and keep going. You know, none of this stopping and milling around nonsense. It's really, really getting on my nerves, and it's probably yours too. I don't have an easy answer, so that's why everybody from this area here all the way down through Edisto Beach, you have to be getting prepared, and areas that are inland, you also need to be thinking about the possibilities of inland impacts that include the strong wind, damaging wind, falling trees, power lines down, flooding rain, and then floods from the river basins, and we will get to that. Lots of stuff that we need to talk about as we progress. So real quick, a geography lesson. This is the North Carolina-Virginia border, and down here is Edisto Beach, and the hurricane watch is for all of this real estate through here, and that includes Charleston and the low country down there, okay, all the way up through Myrtle Beach, Merle's Inlet, the cities and towns of Brunswick County, Wilmington, Jacksonville. These are all, you know, the coastal areas of them. I mean, these don't explicitly include Jacksonville and New Bern, but yes, you're in the hurricane watch. You're going to have more than likely hurricane conditions. Where am I? I'm up here on the Outer Banks of North Carolina. That's it, my location right there, Rodanthe. And it's pretty far to the east here where the Outer Banks sticks out. And my plan is to put a camera system right here in the Rodanthe area, and that will catch any of the onshore overwash or other effects that come off the Atlantic, which could be pretty dramatic. And then I'm going to go down here to Hatteras Village and put another camera system, because this could get hammered even worse, especially if we get a north wind coming down here for a prolonged period of time, really just piling the water up there. So I'm going to put the two camera systems there, and I will put the weather station that I've got, and it's a professional scientific weather station. I didn't buy it at the mall. Nothing wrong with that. I'm just, this is one of your very expensive, extremely reliable weather stations, and all of these go into our app, and we do have that available. I'll talk about that real quick. It's on the App Store, and it's called Hurricane Impact. Now, it is available, or we had it available as an Android version last year, revamped it, but we cannot get the live video to work reliably in the Android version. We worked on it, we worked on it, we worked on it. It costs money to pay the developer. I'm the producer and the director, and then I have to pay somebody. Like when Steven Spielberg makes a movie, he gets his money together, and for the special effects, he goes to Industrial Light and Magic. This is like Industrial Light and Magic saying, "We can't get it to work this time, Mr. Spielberg." And he just says, "I give up." And so I'm not saying that I'm on the level of Steven Spielberg, but I'm trying to give you the analogy. I went to the developers, we worked on it, and we couldn't get it to work. There's something wrong with the way the Android operating system handles the video playback of live video the way that we are doing it. And that is proprietary. I'm not going to talk about that. How we got it in there, but it's just not working. It's not jiving. That being said, if you have our app on Android from last year, the weather data part will work. Me putting videos on the blog part will still work, and in the video section. It's not the whole thing doesn't work, but the most important part for landfall, the live video, is not working for most people, we'll say. I won't say it's 100%, because for some reason it works for some people. So there you go. I wanted to just make that very clear. But on the iOS version for iPhone, it works great. In fact, I use it. I'm always checking it, because I've got the graphics in there and all the things I like to check. So anyhow, that's my plan for today. Set that weather station and the cameras up, and then I will be heading back down to Wilmington, where I live, and be working on plans for camera systems in Other areas, I can absolutely tell you I'll have one in New Bern, right down here on Union Point. I think that's very important. And probably something over here on the southern Outer Banks, and then something certainly down here in my neck of the woods. I have six of them total, and I'm going to have all six of them out. They're all backed up by a GoPro system that will record even if and when, because I think it's inevitable, the network goes down and we lose the feeds. They are backed up via GoPro. So if we lose the feeds, I know it's disappointing because the network fails, but we're still recording at least, which I can show you later. No, that's not helpful in the moment. And in terms of like, well, why don't you use satellite? You know, sure, send me a check for $1 million and I would be glad to do that. I don't even think satellite would work through a hurricane, to be honest with you, because of the signal degradation through all the rain. So it is what it is. You do the best you can with what you've got. And then the second weather station will be set up somewhere probably in the Cape Fear region as well. All right, this was lengthy today, but man, there's a lot going on, and I wanted to tell you a little bit more about my plans as we evolve. All right, so for those of you that are Patreon supporters, I am going to be putting these little mini blogs, kind of video blogs, telling you what I'm doing. I'm giving you my story, so look for that if you're following and supporting on Patreon. Make sure you have the Patreon app, and it'll show up there so you can see what I'm doing. I'll also be posting helpful and relevant information from time to time on Twitter, and then, of course, another update here later this afternoon once the 5 o'clock advisory package comes out. I don't know if it'll be between 5 and 6 p.m., but it will be based on the 5 o'clock advisory. I got to get back home first. So let me shut up and get to work, all right? Thanks for watching. I'm Mark Sutter, HurricaneTrack.com. I'll have another complete and thorough discussion for you this evening.